Coming up on this edition of the FGCU Sports Report, the Pro Scouts descend on the Eagles diamond, looking for the next jewel in the FGCU lineup. We take a look back on the hits and misses of this year for the FGCU volleyball squad. And we talk to Eagles head coach Dave Tollett, find out who is going to step up to the plate this year for his talented baseball team. All that and more on the next FGCU Sports Report.
The FGCU Sports Report is made possible by Fort Myers Toyota, the family store on the big corner of Colonial and Fowler, proud supporter of FGCU Athletics and WGCU Public Broadcasting. Mutual of Omaha Bank, now serving Southwest Florida, your bank every step of the way, a proud supporter of FGCU Athletics and WGCU Public Broadcasting. And the Eagles Club, FGCU Athletics Boosters Club, presenting Dinner on the Diamond Sunday, December 5th, and Golfing with the Greats Monday, December 6th.
Hello, Eagles fans. I'm your host, Tom James, and welcome to the Thanksgiving edition of the FGCU Sports Report. We hope that you are having a great holiday weekend. Well, this past week in sports has been a flurry of splashes, spikes, and swishes. So let's get right to the action. The day before competing in the Georgia Tech Invite, the Eagles swimming and diving team learned that they were ranked number 6 in the first mid-major Division I swimming poll of the year. And the blue and green swimmers were the only team from the Coastal Collegiate Swimming Association to be ranked in the top 25. At the Invite this past weekend, the Eagles measured themselves against some of the best D1 teams in the country and placed a respectable 8th overall in the 13-team field. Texas A&M finished the Invite in first place with a 1,735.5 point total, while Florida State and Florida took second and third, respectively. In hoops action, the women's basketball team took on conference rival Troy at Alico Arena on Sunday, November 21st, trying to keep that home win streak alive. The two teams traded baskets throughout the first half until the Eagles took off on a 12-2 run, highlighted by three consecutive triples by junior Kelsey Jacobson that gave the Eagles a 35-26 lead at the intermission. In the second half, the Eagles kept the pressure on, leading by as many as 16 at one point, and cruised to a 12-point win, 60-48. With the win, the Lady Eagles extend their home winning streak to an amazing 26 games. FGCU's winning streak now ranks third in the nation behind UConn and Stanford after Lehigh was defeated at home by Princeton over the weekend. The FGCU women improve their record to 2-0 on the season, while the Troy Trojans fall to 0-4. And the men's basketball team completed a two-game road trip this past week, first traveling to beautiful Grambling, Louisiana to take on the Grambling State Tigers in their first ever matchup with the university. The second half saw the Eagles build some leads only to have the Tigers come roaring back to keep the game close, but an 11-2 spurt with 4 minutes left gave the Eagles their largest lead of the game, and they were able to hang on for a 74-70 victory. Then on Monday the 22nd, the Eagles traveled up to Fayetteville and ran straight into some red-hot Razorbacks. Junior Tim Snyder opened the game with a put-back dunk to put the Eagles in front, but then it was all Arkansas after that. The Razorbacks went on a 20-zip run in the opening 5 minutes and drained 14 three-pointers in the game to bury the Eagles 90-47. The loss drops FGCU to 2-2 for the season, while the Razorbacks improved to 2-0 with the win. The A-Sun Volleyball Championship took place right here at Alico Arena, November the 18th through the 20th. On Saturday, it was no surprise to find defending A-Sun champs Lipscomb on the court for the championship game. What was surprising was to see Lipscomb, who had dropped only 5 sets in conference play all season, down 2-0 to start the match. The Lady Bisons were not about to go down without a fight, however. With a dominating 15-8 performance in the final set, the Lady Bisons completed the comeback to claim back-to-back titles and send Lipscomb to the NCAA tournament for the third time in the past 4 years. Our hats off to the Lipscomb volleyball squad, and we wish them the best of luck in the NCAAs. And the Lady Eagles didn't compete in the A-Sun Championships this year, but there were still a lot of positives to take away from this past season. Sports reporter Rochelle Grossman takes a look at the ups and downs of the Eagles season.
down, but nowhere near out, the Eagles volleyball team has a lot to look forward to. And getting back to their winning ways is priority one.
The silver lining is the kids, the way they've handled it, and the fact that they've played really hard down the stretch. They're going hard in practice. They're being delightful people. They're showing character. That's the silver lining.
The Eagles, led by senior Chelsea Lyles and junior Holly Youngquist, continue to rally the team down the stretch, working hard at practice and finishing strong. The Eagles scored a victory beating Stetson in the Nest on Senior Day, the last home game for Lyles and five other seniors.
Adrian, who I also played basketball with, as soon as she walked into the locker room, she just started crying. It's like, I can't even deal with her because I don't want to get emotional, but it's definitely emotional just because, you know, I've been here for 3 years and realizing this is my last time, you know, playing most likely in the States and just playing in front of my mom and dad. It's definitely something very emotional for me.
After this season, Lyles, also a star basketball player, hopes to take her talents overseas, playing hoops in Europe before putting her bachelor's degree in communications and efforts toward a master's degree in social work to good use.
So if I don't go into coaching or if I don't go overseas after this year, I want to work in a hospital with abused children.
Junior Holly Youngquist plans to be back for her fourth and final season leading the Eagles. A standout player, she's been named second team All-Atlantic Sun by the conference this year. With a team-high 389 digs, 17 service aces, 44 kills, and 54 assists, she's sure to be a big factor next year, too. She says this season's final tally isn't a good indicator of how well the women gelled.
Since I've been here, actually, it was the best year that we've had, and it's so sad that the game schedule didn't turn out the way that our season actually went, because we all had a ton of fun. We love each other like we're going to be best friends forever.
Youngquist joins five others who've earned first or second team honors in the volleyball program's four-year play at the Division I level. She's also been named to the ESPN Academic All-District 3 second team. And with an older sister currently playing on the Pro Beach Tour, she says volleyball is in her blood.
Every time you touch the ball, it matters, and you're always going to touch the ball no matter what. It's just like a fast-paced sport, and it's something that you love. Next year, I hope we just start off stronger.
That's also the goal for Eagles coach Dave Nichols, who in 30 years of coaching has never experienced a losing season.
It cut like a knife, and it took a lot of inward reflection to even make it through. I keep saying, okay, there's a message for me, there's a lesson to be learned. Whatever it wasn't that much fun, but let's hope that it doesn't happen again.
Nichols, regarded as a premier volleyball coach, boasts two national championships. And with this year's tough schedule behind him, he's now turning his focus to next year, hoping for a healthy team and new recruits to come in playing strong. He thanks the fans for their never-ending support.
An involved and classy set of fans, and they're passionate, supportive. I mean, I've been so overwhelmed with the kindness of the fans in a year where really we've struggled.
Next, we'd like to honor Chelsea Lyles.
Nichols hopes senior players like Lyles will appreciate the memories and cherish these moments.
For most girls, it's the last true competition they're going to have. So this is their last kind of big moment in front of a crowd, in front of family, doing something this passionate. And, you know, it's unique. You go to work and people aren't cheering or booing on what you just did on your computer. I want them to continue to play with the spirit and the passion that they've been showing down the stretch. And I want them to walk away with their last memory being a great memory.
For the FGCU Sports Report, I'm Rochelle Grossman.
All right, thanks, Rochelle. FGCU baseball coach Dave Tollett is our feature interview this week. Coach, appreciate you stopping by. You're getting ready for your ninth season with FGCU. Needless to say, you've not had a lot of clunkers so far. Let me read you off some of these win totals here. 35, 38, 37, 40, 40, 38, 36, and 38. And you've only lost as many as 20 games once. What's the secret?
Coaching. No, I tell you, it's been It's been an unbelievable ride from us starting from zero scholarships all the way now to a Division I. Along the way, there's been a lot of changes, but it's been a lot of fun. And I tell you what, if we can just keep this train rolling, we'd be very happy.
Yeah. Three-time defending ASUN regular season conference champs, three-time defending coach of the year. What do those accolades, you know, do for the program?
Well, you know, the coach of the year, I mean, that's – you only get that if you win. And so, I mean, that award is just as much a team award as it is an individual award. Being three-time Atlantic Sun Conference champions, I think, being only in the league 3 years, I think that speaks volumes of where our program is at. And I think each year we're getting better, so we're still on the rise.
Yeah, you're three for three.
Three for three.
You're growing major league talent. I mean, it's happening. You know, Chris Sale with the White Sox, Casey Coleman with the Cubs. What kind of pride does that give you to see this program bearing that kind of fruit?
Oh, I think it's just awesome to have Chris and Casey. And, you know, we have a couple more in the minor leagues that are close. I think just the development of those kids, and I tell you what, they've been great ambassadors since they've reached the big leagues about FGCU and the FGCU baseball program. But they have been absolutely awesome to have, and boy, I tell you what, it's been a nice ride for us also.
Do you draw on those guys? You know, they come back to the program now since, I mean, they haven't been gone very long, but do they come back and kind of talk to your current players and give them some inspiration?
Yeah, I mean, they're in the dugout. I mean, they were back for the Blue-Green World Series because, you know, it's always a lot of fun, and they remember that. And both of them kind of said, I still get nervous about this. But I tell you what, they're around quite a bit.
You recently, or you just mentioned the Eagle Pro Day, which is with the scouts. They get to, you know, look at the players, look at your guys who get to show off for them. What's that like for the players?
Well, Pro Day is their day. I mean, it's their chance because every one of our kids, since they could walk, they want to be a Chris Sale or Casey Coleman. So, I mean, it's really neat that we can bring all 30 major league clubs to FGCU. And when we first started Pro Day, we usually have about 14 or 15. But now after our successes, I mean, we have a full house.
Earlier this month, you had the Blue-Green World Series. It's sort of the civil war of FGCU baseball, if you will. Talk about what that is about and what those guys are playing for.
For us as a coaching staff, it's the closest thing that we can simulate to a game and put some things on there and let kids compete against each other. And the competition is by far the best of the fall. So it's really neat. We put a lot of things on the line to even make it more competitive, we have duties. If you win, you get to pick your duties. If you lose, the winners pick your duties. So first seat on the bus, first in line at the restaurants when we stop, only 3 work days on the field compared to 5 work days on the field. So there's a lot on the line for these guys, and so they go at it pretty hard.
That's a lot to fight for.
Yeah, that's a lot to fight for.
Question about your past. I mean, people forget quickly that you've had a past here in Southwest Florida that precedes coaching FGCU baseball. You were at Charlotte High School in Punta Gorda for, 10 years before you came here?
Yeah, I mean, I was born and raised in Southwest Florida. So, from Charlotte High to FGCU, I mean, we had a lot of success at Charlotte High School with, you know, Matt LaPorta, who's in the big leagues with the, and then Tommy Murphy, who was with the Angels. So, I mean, we had a lot of success at Charlotte High School, and we're having a lot of success at FGCU, but I just love Southwest Florida.
What was that transition like, going from high school baseball to college baseball?
Not as bad as what people think, because there were some teams at Charlotte that could have beat my first couple teams here at FGCU because, we were NAIA and non-scholarship at the time. So transition was not as tough as people would think. Now, I think if you go from high school to Division I right now, I think it would be tough.
Parents and kids out there in Southwest Florida should take note. You've got 3 baseball camps coming up, I believe, in the month of December. Tell us a little bit about what those entail and what those are all about.
Well, our first one is the showcase camp, and it is full, 250 kids already, and, I mean, It's full every year, but we do some things for kids that most showcase camps are $500, and ours is $185, and right now we're bringing in 18 college coaches from all over the country, from Oklahoma State to Maryland. So it gives kids a chance to get looked at a pretty good fair price, and not $500 that some of these camps are charging.
Wow, that's a good value.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, just out of this camp alone last year, we signed five kids. Wow. So, I mean, it's very valuable for us as a recruiting tool also.
Finally, last question, what do you look for out of your team in the coming season and out of the conference? How's the conference stacking up against you guys?
Well, most of the time I'm Lou Holtz, but no, I think we're going to be very solid. We return seven starters positionally. It's going to be hard to replace the National Player of the Year in Chris Sale. So we're going to go as far as our pitching allows us, and I think we're better on the bump if you take away one player than we were last year. So some guys need to step up, but we're looking forward to it. I wish it was February right now.
We wish you the best of luck.
Well, thank you.
Coach Dave Tollett, FGCU Baseball, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
And, of course, to get all the latest news, scores, and more for all of FGCU sports, log on to FGCUathletics.com, the official site of the FGCU Eagles. Well, each week on the Sports Report, we like to recognize some of FGCU's stellar student athletes. Our first player profile this week is on women's basketball player Kelsey Jacobson. Let's take a look.
I chose FGCU, one, because the program is unbelievable. Coach Mesko has done a great job here. When I came on my visit, the girls were extremely friendly. I really enjoyed it, and they all seemed like they had a great desire for basketball, and that's what I was looking for. It was amazing. It wasn't anything I expected. You know, I came in here and I was just a little freshman. I didn't really know what the college scene was going to be like. Playing against all these Division I schools, it was a tough game every game. And then to win the ASUN, it was just a dream come true for a freshman. We won the ASUN conference that year. We went to WNIT. It was a great season as a team. But it's an honor to be named Freshman of the Year. I mean, that's quite a challenge, seeing as the freshmen in the other conferences are extremely good. We like to set our goals high. We want to win the ASUN. We want to, you know, compete every game. We want to have a 20-plus season, but our main focus is winning the ASUN championship. Beating Florida for my very first game as a freshman, that was really something. All the fans were here, they were going crazy, and it was such a close game, 88-86. That was probably the best memory I have. After FGCU, I'm looking to go to med school, plan on becoming a doctor.
Well, the success of FGCU's baseball program has certainly attracted a lot of attention. So when the Eagles recently hosted their annual Pro Day, it was a major league event. Sports reporter Katie Kaufman was there and files this report.
All eyes were on FGCU baseball last season after two Eagle alums, Chris Sale and Casey Coleman, made their major league debuts. So this year, when FGCU invited major league teams to their annual Pro Day, 29 out of 30 MLB scouts swarmed Swanson Stadium looking for the next Eagle ace.
Today is Major League Scout Day here, and we've been having it for all 10 years. And what it is gives the Major League Scouts a chance to see our players up close and firsthand. We've had a lot of success with Sale and Coleman and Blyer and the rest of the guys that have got drafted. But what it does, it gives the scouts a chance to see them, and if they like someone, then they come back during the spring and evaluate them in a game-like situation.
Freshman Sean Dwyer was drafted in the 42nd round of the 2010 draft by the San Diego Padres. But the 6'1" outfielder chose FGCU over starting a pro career.
Education's a big thing, and this program. It was the first school to talk to me. I fell in love with it first time I came here. Coaches are great, and I really got along with the players, so I felt like it was a great fit.
Catcher Mike Reeves was drafted in 2009, and like Dwyer, postponed professional ball in favor of a college career.
I was in the 42nd round of the Toronto Blue Jays in 2009,
Well, when I was going through the process or whatever, it was just a better fit for me to come here and go to college and experience the college life and stuff like that, and kind of doing a little growing up before I go to pro ball.
The Minnesota Twins have close ties to Southwest Florida, holding their annual spring training in Fort Myers. Twins scout Billy Corrigan let us in on what they look for in future MLB prospects.
We come out, we try to look for players that'll be eligible for the Major League Draft for this spring. And we look for all kinds of players. We look for pitchers that have size, guys that have good arm strength, that have good pitches, position players that have tools that can run, throw, play defense, and can hit.
Spending the day at Swanson Stadium is extra special for Corrigan. The Illinois native wore an Eagle uniform in 2003 as a catcher on the first ever FGCU baseball roster.
I was here when they started and we didn't have a baseball field. It was just an intramural field out in the middle of nowhere past Alico Arena. And, you know, we started with a lot of guys. There was very minimal scholarships, just a lot of people that came from junior college and just wanted to take a chance on an up-and-coming university. And since I was here, the program has changed immensely. It's progressed along far more than we could have imagined. And now Dave and the coaching staff have done a wonderful job. They've got a legitimate program where they can contend and battle quality Division I programs.
The Chicago White Sox's lanky lefty Chris Sale pitched from FGCU's mound just last season, but came out to Pro Day to support his former teammates.
It's nerve-wracking, you know, being here, and you know, you always feel like you have to do better than you can, or you know, go out there and you know, you have to be your best. You know, I mean, you just pretty much have to come out here and play your game. I remember being so nervous before this stuff, like, oh my gosh, these are scouts for like pro teams, and so I mean, it was nerve-wracking, but it was also a lot of fun. It was probably one of the funnest days. This and the Blue Green World Series are the funnest days of the fall because it's kind of your day just to go out and show what you've done throughout the fall.
White Sox scout Jose Ortiega was in the stands on Pro Day and was the same guy who urged the Sox to select Sale in the 2010 draft. The 21-year-old was drafted 13th overall and became the first of his draft class to be promoted to the majors, throwing against the Baltimore Orioles on August 6, 2010.
Well, the program is going up. As you see today, out of 30 teams, we got 28 teams here. So when you got a first runner like that, a lot of people are, you know, attention is here right now. He's done a great job right here. We're looking for a guy who can pitch like Chris did and who can hit and run. We're looking for the best talent there is.
With former Eagles like Sale and Coleman who have made it to the show, are the players still in green and blue feeling the pressure from the Major League scouts?
Oh, not at all. I come out here every day and just try to do the same thing. So if someone's watching the crowd, then that's how it is. If no one's there, that's how it is. I just go out and do my thing every day.
I don't really feel any pressure. They've seen me before. If they like what they see, then so be it. You know, it's just kind of do what I do on the field.
They're definitely looking at us a little extra because there's been some big players come out of here. But no, you know, it's just they kind of just put a stepping stone for us.
Thank you, Katie. And of course, for all the latest news, scores, and schedules for all of FGCU sports, log on to FGCUathletics.com, the official site of the FGCU Eagles. For our second player profile this week, we shine the Sports Report spotlight on men's basketball standout, Reed Baker. Let's check it out.
I chose to come to FGCU. I'm from the area. I know it's got a great program, and I just wanted to be a part of something new. My first year here I was a red shirt. It was their first year Division I. Just since then, I've seen it take off. You know, things have just gotten a lot better. Organization's gotten a lot better, and plus, you know, the athletic department's changed, and we got a new great AD in there.
It was a lot of fun. That's, you know, we all look forward to playing in that kind of atmosphere. Anthony, he just, you know, he's a great finisher. He's got great touch around the basket. He's quicker than everyone that guards him. So it's just like, it's an easy answer to give him the ball. So I'm always looking for him.
Just, you know, to have a good season, win the Atlantic Sun, have a good year personally, and just have fun out there my last year. just the camaraderie about my teammates. We've all, like, you know, lifelong friends and we've spent so much time together. So, you know, I'll hold out onto that forever. Hopefully I'll be able to go play overseas. So that's what I'm looking to do.
Now let's take a look at what's coming up on the FGCU sports schedule for next week. The women's basketball team will be traveling to Jacksonville for a pair of road games next week. On December the 2nd, the Lady Eagles will play the North Florida Ospreys in a conference matchup. Game time set for 5:30. Then, after a day off to see the sights, the Blue and Green tip off against the Jacksonville University Dolphins in another important A-Sun Conference game. The schedule launch for that one is 1 p.m. The men's basketball squad also happens to be in Jacksonville for a pair of games that same weekend. On both days, the men are the second bill of a basketball doubleheader, taking on UNF on the 2nd with tip off at 7:45 p.m. And then on the 4th, they follow the women's game at Jacksonville University with a game time scheduled for 3:15. We wish the Eagles the best of luck next week. Well, that's going to do it for us at the FGCU Sports Report. I'm Tom James, and we will see you all next week. And go Eagles!